let's talk about the big elephant in the room, and that is, can the 2018 Leaf rapid charge? So last week, I tested the new Nissan Leaf. If you haven't seen the video already, look at the top right, there's a little eye. Click that and you can watch the review of that before you watch this one and come back to this later. But the one thing I didn't do is I didn't drive it. It was mainly looking at the outside and seeing what I thought of the car and, you know, the inside and the practicality of it. Now, the reason I didn't drive it is to drive an electric car and test it properly, you need to sort of drive it to the max, sort of running it out until it's flat, rapid charging it, driving it again, and then maybe another rapid charge. This gives you a proper indication of how the car sort of performs long distance and how many charges it will do. And unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to do that. But luckily for me, some other YouTubers have tested it out. One of them is the famous Tesla Born. So one of the things that Tesla Born found out was when he went to go and CHAdeMO charge it at a 50 kilowatt CHAdeMO station, the initial charge rate was extremely high. It charged very quick, very, very quick, very, very soon, very early on. On the 50 kilowatt charging station, he was charging at 45 kilowatts, which on a 50 kilowatt car, you know, charging station when it's cold, is a very, very high charging sort of rate to get straight away on a Leaf. So initially, it seemed, for the first part of the charge, as quick as the 30 kilowatt charger, and the percentage bar and the mileage range was going up very, very rapidly from a low state of charge, which you'd expect in any battery. As I've explained before, the stadium effect, it is much easier to cram more electrons into an empty stadium, empty battery, than it is to start cramming new electrons into an already full stadium. So the initial low state of health, SOH is the key word for that, is it was very quick, it was very rapid, it got it in very fast. If you haven't already, just click the subscribe button down the bottom. I make new video every single week about electric cars, and it'd be nice to see you again next week. Now let me explain some acronyms that I'm going to use in this video. One of them is BMS, which is Battery Management System. The other one is TMS, which is Temperature Management System. So we've got TMS and BMS. The BMS controls the way the battery charges, the rates it's charging at, and it also controls the temperature management system, the TPS, so it controls the battery temperature. Now, most cars, electric cars now, will have a temperature management system, so they'll have a cooling system to keep the battery pack cool, and a heating system to heat the battery pack up. Now, what he found is when the state of charge got to 65%, the charge rate tailed off very quickly, dropped down to about 35 kilowatts, which is a fairly big drop. Now, what Tesla Born noticed is, as the charge rate got to 65%, the battery was only half warm, it was only halfway on heat, but the charge rate dropped to 35 kilowatts, so there was a massive drop in the charge rate very, very quickly. Now, this can be down to a couple of reasons. One will be the battery management system is detecting that the battery is getting warm, and to protect that state of health of the battery and the long lasting part of the battery, it is reducing the charge rate to lower the impact of the heat on the battery. But as he noticed, the heat was only halfway, it wasn't very, very hot. Now, if you don't know his channel, he films, I think it's in Norway, which is obviously a very cold climate. In all the video where he was driving the new Nissan Leaf, it was snow, it was cold, it was probably about minus three, minus four, minus five. And also eco cars, they had a race competition between three different cars. One was a 30 kilowatt Leaf and one was the new Leaf, and on that drive the 30 kilowatt Leaf, the old shaped Leaf, beat the new Leaf, and that was down to the charge rate again dropping off very suddenly when the battery got warm. Now the worrying part is it's doing this at cold climates at the moment. The week that eco cars did it was the Sunday that we all got snow, so very, very cold temperatures. We're talking single digit figures. The worrying part for me is if you bought the new Leaf and you're hoping to do long distance rapid charges, and we're in a summer month, and we have a well, we don't often get double figures in England, but let's just say we had a nice scorching 23, 25 degree summer, you know, very, very warm heat wave summer, the chances are that the charge rate would drop even sooner because the battery heat wouldn't be cooled by the surrounding air, it would stay warm. And if you wanted to do multiple rapid charges, so you did drive to a rapid charger, charge, and then drove to another rapid charger, the charge rate would drop even more suddenly, which is worrying. I mean, to be honest, when I heard that the new Leaf was coming out and it didn't have any you know, temperature management system in the BMS to take care of the battery, I was a little bit worried because, I mean, even this little car, the Zoe, the first generation Zoes had cooling to keep the battery pack cold on rapid charges. And obviously the new generation ZE40 Zoes, they also have a temperature management system for cooling. And in cold climates, they also have a battery heater to keep the battery system warm. And these two things, to look after the battery temperature will look after the battery's health. And the early 30 kilowatt Leafs, I'm going to upset a lot of you Leaf lovers here, but the state of health of your battery is never as good as a Renault Zoe battery. The percentage of your health is much lower than what the Zoe battery is if it's been rapid charging. And the reason for that is the Zoe's battery management system takes better care of the battery because it's got active cooling. So if you're doing lots of rapid charging, it keeps that cells nice and cold, nice and cool, and looks after it. And in the ZE40, it's even better because it's got heating, which will heat the cell up so you can get to a rapid charge temperature much quicker, and also it looks after the way the battery's looked after. It's much better health. For example, this one that I'm selling now has a 99% state of health. My Zoe, which has done 14,000 miles, has a 98% state of health. So very, very high state of health for, you know, 2015 plate cars. But you look at the comparable Nissan Leafs and they're talking 92, 96, they're much lower states of health. Now, you're all going, all the Leaf owners now are going to put in the comments what the state of health is. Make sure you include the year, the mileage, and what your state of health is off Leaf Spy, if you've got the Leaf Spy. And then Renault Zoe owners, if you've got Can ZE, make sure you put on the bottom at the bottom your mileage, your state of health on your Zoe, and then we can do a fair comparison. But from all the figures I've seen from being in the Leaf forum and being in the Zoe forum, the Zoe has a better state of health on the older battery. But what we obviously think of the Nissan have done on the new Leaf is they want to get that state of health a lot higher. They want to improve the state of health. So the battery management system is tailing off the quick charging as quick as it can to lower the risk of temperature damage, thermal impact on the battery cells. The question you want to ask is, does it put me off buying a Nissan Leaf 2018? And the answer is no, it doesn't, not really. Every car has its own faults. So they've both got their advantages and disadvantages. For example, the Renault Zoe can only charge by AC, which is alternating current. There's no DC option on it, which is a bit of a letdown off Renault. I did the video about the 2018 release of the new Renault Zoe, which is the new upgraded horsepower engine, video top right. And in that, there's no news of CCS, which is a bit disappointing off Renault, and at the moment there's no news that a 2018 will have CCS, which will allow DC direct current charging. And that is a disadvantage to the Renault, and the reason for that is companies like InstaVolt, which are deciding to fit DC only charging stations, which is more of a terrible company decision, but it does let Renault Zoe owners down, because as we need more rapid chargers to move around the country, companies like InstaVolt are choosing not to fit them. And Traffic for London have even started to try and remove AC plugs from their rapid chargers, claiming that no car can AC rapid charge. Obviously, they don't know about Europe's best-selling EV, which is obviously the Zoe. In return, the Leaf obviously has faults for rapid charging across the country. If the charge rate's slowing down to a crawl even before the battery's warm, if you're wanting to do a big jump across the country, or even, let's say you don't have a charger at home, so you're going to go on a long journey from, say, Scotland to Manchester, and you charge up at Scotland at your local rapid charger because you haven't got a home charger, so you rapid charge to get a charge to go to where you're going. That heats the cells up, gets the battery warm. You then drive down on at high speed, which keeps the battery pack warm, and then you go to your next rapid, and you go to rapid again. The battery cell's still warm, so your charge rate will stay low. You might then need another rapid charger before you get where you're going, and if the cells are still warm, you're going to charge very slowly, in which case you would have been better buying the 30 kilowatt Nissan Leaf, which will allow the battery temperature to get even higher and allow the charge rate to stay very high for a longer period of time. Now, there's a couple of things that could cause this low state of charge rate from Nissan's new Leaf, and one of them is obviously the temperature management system that I've mentioned. The other one is chemistry. It could be the BMS knows that the chemistry of the battery can't handle certain temperature states, or it's protecting it in case you suddenly unplug the charger while it's really hot battery cell and then drive it really hot fast, and because it hasn't got any way of controlling that temperature, it's protecting the cells early while you're rapid before you then start driving and increasing the temperature even more. So there's a couple of things that could be at play. It could be that the technology, the cell chemistry that they've used, is designed to be a hybrid between charging and between vehicle to grid, because the Nissan Leaf now comes equipped with vehicle to grid technology, so you can actually plug your car into your house and run your home for like 2-3 days. So is the chemistry favouring quick discharge for vehicle to grid, and therefore it can't charge very quickly? I mean, there's a few unanswered questions here off Nissan, and maybe we'll see some updates off them. It could be that there's a fault in the BMS software. So they might release a patch to the firmware which will allow the car to reach a higher temperature rate before it tails off the charge. The Zoe also tails off a charge when it gets to a high state of charge and a high battery temperature, because like I said before, the stadium effect, they will slow down as they get to higher charge rates. But the fact that you can buy a 30 kilowatt Leaf and drive long distance quicker than the new Leaf with a bigger battery is a little bit worrying. It lets you know that they're being a little bit too conservative on the battery temperature. Now, it should be noted, when I spoke to Aaron, I did actually ask him, because he's the owner of the Leaf I tested last week. I actually asked him, has he noticed any problems with CHAdeMO charging, fast charging? And he said he hadn't noticed any significant tails off or problems. But he's not done massive long distances like Tesla Born did in his test drive and Eco Cars did in their test run. So it might be more the fact that you need multiple charging. Now, if you've seen Tesla Bond's video, he appeared to only do one rapid, but if you see at the start of the video, he started on a rapid, just like that example I just gave you from going from Scotland, and then went to another rapid. So the issue with the Leaf does seem to be, from some couple of the vloggers that have covered it, seems to be multiple rapid chargers. So one rapid charger doesn't tend to affect the way the battery acts, but if you're doing multiple rapid charges, that's when it seems to slow down the charge. In comparison, the Zoe Q motor also does the same if you start rapid charging it quite a lot and the battery temperature gets high. However, because of the active cooling, the temperature is brought down and therefore the rapid charge rate's increased again. It's too early days to tell, and there's not enough people out there testing the Leaf for multiple rapid charges to make a full impact on whether this is an isolated issue with a couple of cars. However, it does seem weird that Tesla Born also had the issue, and Eco Cars. One's obviously in Norway and one's a UK model. It could be an issue, something to do with the BMS system needing a firmware update, like I said before. It could be down to the temperature management system of the Leaf trying to protect the battery, but because obviously it hasn't got active cooling, it can't bring that temperature down quick enough to allow high states of charge. So it's very, very, very hard to say until there's more data out there. But I'm going to sort of, from the data I've seen, the information I've seen, I'm going to guess it's to do with Nissan trying to protect the cells so you get better state of health, SOH, for the longevity of the Leaf's life. They're probably bargaining that you'll be doing less rapid charges on a car that's got higher range, which is a good bet. I mean, in theory, if you did, let's just take the worst possible sort of NEDC figures, etc., for the car. Let's say you had a full charge, about 140 odd mile charge, and you could do two charges. You could do almost 300 miles were only charging once at a rapid. That's if you were fully charged at home. And based on that, if the slow rate of charge happens on the second charge, it's very unlikely to affect the majority of drivers, and therefore the SOH becomes more important. But if you haven't got a home charger and your majority of your charging is going to be done at rapid, so in the morning when you charge up it's going to be coming off a rapid red hot and you're going to go to a second rapid red hot, then yes, it's probably going to affect long term distance compared to something like the Renault Zoe. But no EV is perfect. I mean, like I said, I'm an owner of one of these. I'm an owner of a Zoe, and I love it. I love it to bits. Would I not buy a Leaf because of the charge rate slowing down? Well, you know, to a slower rate? No, it won't put me off. At the end of the day, the new Leaf is pretty. It's a good-looking car. It's packed full of features. Even the base model has a fair few extras of the launch, and that's on the launch edition ones. So the various extras you get on them is very, very good. It's bigger than the Zoe. It's got a bigger room in the back. It's more comfortable. There's a little bit more brake horsepower in it, and obviously it's better built because it's built by Nissan. Would I also not buy the Zoe because of the new Leafs out? No, I'd still buy the Zoe. They're both good cars. They both fit different needs. Personally, I like the looks of the Zoe over the Leaf still. Even though the Leaf is better looking, I'd still buy my Zoe. And the fact that the major advantage is on the Zoe, you've got 22 kilowatt charging even on the R model AC, where on the Leaf you are either DC CHAdeMOing or your 7 kilowatt AC. And the amount of AC 22 kilowatts around the UK and also Ireland, then to me the Zoe's still winning. The Zoe's in front because the most Europe still has lots and lots of AC 22 kilowatts because it's just direct feed off the grid. So on that, to me, the Zoe still wins for versatility for charging. However, the Leaf's still a fantastic car. If you're thinking of buying either the Leaf or the Zoe, then it's just put it down to personal preference. Which one do you prefer the look of? Which one do you prefer the size of? Which price do you prefer? Thanks very much for watching this week's video. Don't forget to subscribe, don't forget to like it, and I'll see you again next week. Thanks very much for watching. Goodbye.